Can you hear me? Okay, today's topic is endometriosis. So let's see the definition of endometriosis. It's the presence of tissue that is morphologically and biologically similar to normal endometrium and contains functional endometrium, glands and stroma outside the uterine cavity. As you all know that endometrial, functional endometrial, glands and stroma are only present in the endometrium. But in the case of endometriosis, it is found outside the uterine cavity. So let's see the epidemiology. It's globally 90 million suffering from the endometriosis. Its prevalence is 2 to 10% in the reproductive age group. And in infertile women, it is 20 to 40%. Its peak incidence is around 30 to 45 years of age. And it is found in all the races. So let's see the sites of endometriosis. Usually it is found in the uterine serosa, fallopian tube, ovaries. And next is uterovesical fold, retrovaginal septum and uterosacral ligaments, sigmoid colon, ureter, small bowels, umbilicus, cecum. That means it is found in everywhere in the pelvic organs. So let's see the pathogenesis of endometriosis. There are two theories. One is implantation or metastatic theory. That is retrograde menstruation, which is common in young girls. That is due to the genital flow, outflow obstruction. And this is the physiological phenomenon. So you can see the retrograde outflow of the menstrual blood through uterine cavity to the fallopian tube, fimbria, and in the ovary and in the pelvic cavity. So next is metaplasia theory. It is the changes in coelomic membrane towards endometrial-like tissue following prolonged irritation or estrogen stimulation. So it is 7 times more common in the first degree relatives, more common in monozygotic twins than in dizygotic twins, decreased cellular immunity to endometriotic tissues. So let's see the symptoms. Usually in the reproductive organs, 60% comes with the symptoms of dysmenorrhea, dyspareunia around 25 to 40%. Usually patient comes with lower abdomen, pelvic or low back pain. And there might be chronic pelvic pain in 30 to 50%. And around 10 to 20%, there may be menstrual irregularities. And in most of the infertility cases, there might be 30 to 40% of endometriosis. In GI tract, symptoms may be cyclical rectal bleeding, tenesmus, dyschezia, diarrhea, or cyclic constipation. It is also found in the lungs, and the symptoms may be cyclic hemoptysis, blood-stained pleural effusions, and pneumothorax. Sometimes it is also found in the umbilicals or surgical scars. If you come to the OPD, you can also see patients coming with cyclic bleeding or swelling in the umbilicus or surgical scars. So there might be cyclic pain and swelling. What are the signs of endometriosis? There might be pelvic tenderness, fixed retroverted uterus, nodularity of the Douglas pouch and uterosacral ligaments. Ovaries may be enlarged or tender during vaginal examination, and there might be cyst. So what are the investigations we need to do in the endometriosis? So the gold standard diagnosis test for endometriosis is laparoscopy. It permits to see and treat approach. That is, we can see and treat accordingly during laparoscopy. In addition, we can also send the CA125, which is a cancer antigen. Is a glycoprotein found in epithelium of fallopian tube, endometrium, ovarian tissue, endocervix, perimetrium, and pleura. but it is not useful for screening because of poor sensitivity, which is 28%, but its specificity is 90%. Elevated level has been correlated with severity of endometriosis, and it is detected by monoclonal antibody assay. The next one is CA19-9. It's the antigenic glycoprotein, also shown to be positively correlated with severity of endometriosis. So other investigation we send is ultrasound. It is the first line of investigation. We can do transabdominal, transvaginal, or endorectal. We can, from ultrasound, we can detect endometrial mass, but sensitivity for local endometrial implants is very poor. So next one is a CT scan, in which endometrial mass may appear solid, cystic, or mixed mass. The next one is MRI. Role is limited in visualizing small endometriotic implants and adhesions. It's more useful for lesions in extraperitoneal locations. It's more frequently used in staging and treatment response to the monitoring. So the treatment is, we need to consider age, symptoms, stage, and infertility. Our goal is to decrease the pain and preserve or restoration of fertility. So first of all, for that, we need to discuss with the patient, and the disease may be chronic or not curable. Optimal treatment unproven or non-existent. So line of management is expectant, medical, hormonal, or surgical. So let's see the expectant management. In young women, asymptomatic infertile patient with mild endometriosis with minimal symptoms. If the woman is of perimenopausal age, if pregnancy does not achieve within 12 to 18 months of observation, hormonal or surgical treatment is indicated. If the patient is symptomatic with minimal or mild lesions, then we give NSAIDs or opioids. So this hormone treatment produces pseudo-pregnancy or pseudo-menopause, in which we give combined estrogen, progesterone pills, progestins, danazol, gestrinone, GnRH agonists, and aromatase inhibitor. So let's see. For the indications for hormonal treatment are small and superficial lesions, recurrence after conservative surgery, preoperative for 6 to 12 weeks to decrease size of lesions, postoperative for residual lesions when surgery is contraindicated or refused by the patient. So in these cases, we can give hormonal treatment. Endometriosis in retrovaginal septum and laparotomy scar doesn't respond to the hormonal therapy. So first of all, we can give the combined OCP pills, one pill per day, either continuously or cyclically. Continuous regimen is superior in patients with dysmenorrhea for 6 to 9 months. So it is given regularly for continuously for 6 to 9 months. The adverse effects may be weight gain, abnormal bleeding, and hypertension. Progestational drugs, medoxyprogesterone, which is also known as Provera, is commonly used. The dose is 20 to 30 mg per day for 6 to 9 months. And its adverse effect is abnormal uterine bleeding, nausea, breast tenderness, fluid retention, and depression. So usually in our setup, we can use the danazol, which causes the anovulation by attenuating the mid-cycle surge of luteinizing hormone, inhibiting multiple enzymes in steroidogenic pathway, which increases the testosterone levels, and the dose is usually 400 to 800 mg per day for 6 months. It is given continuously without breaking in between, and the adverse effects are androgenic effects of serum lipids, decreased bone mineral density, and liver damage. The next one is gestrinone. It is anti-progestational steroid, which causes the decreased estrogen and progesterone receptors. It is given 5 to 10 mg per week, daily or twice a week, three times a week for 6 to 9 months. And its adverse effects are deepening of voice, hirsutism, and clitoral hypertrophy. So this is the GnRH agonist, which decreases the follicle stimulating hormone and luteinizing hormone and results in endometrial atrophy and amenorrhea. And it is given intranasally or subcutaneous or intramuscular with a frequency of twice daily to once in 3 months up to 3 to 6 months. Its adverse effects are transient vaginal bleeding, hot flushes, vaginal dryness, decreased libido, breast tenderness, insomnia, depression, irritability, fatigue, headache, osteoporosis, and decreased elasticity of the skin. And GnRH agonist plus add backup therapy, that is estrogen and progesterone. It might give the less side effects, but with same efficacy can be continued beyond 6 months. And these aromatase inhibitors are the new upcoming drugs in the management of endometriosis, which locally inhibit estrogen action in addition to inhibiting estrogen production in the ovary, brain, and the periphery. So let's come to the surgical management. This is the picture of the surgical management, that is laparotomy versus laparoscopy. So let's see the laparoscopic. It is a conservative treatment in which excision, cauterization, and evaporations are done. Surgeries for endometrioma, that is cystectomy, is done with drainage and coagulation. And for the pain management, uterosacral nerve ablation, which is also known as UNA, or presacral neuroectomy. For the radical surgeries, we go for hysterectomy with plus minus. That means either bilateral salping oophorectomy or unilateral salping oophorectomy, depending upon the effect of endometriosis. So in the conclusion, we can see the treatment that if there is a pelvic pain and suspected endometriosis, first of all, drug of choice is NCIDs or OCPs. If the patient gets relief from these medicines, then we can continue the same therapy. If NSAIDs or OCPs doesn't work, then we give the empirical GnRH agonist, that plus estrogen and progesterone add back therapy. If it is, this medicine improves, then we continue the same therapy. If it fails, then we go for operative laparoscopy. And after laparoscopic treatment, then we give the GnRH therapy. So next, if the patient is infertile and suspected endometriosis, we go for operative laparoscopy. We'll watch and see if there is any success or if there is any improving during the laparoscopic. We can do the diagnostic treatment, and further we can advise for the pregnancy if the patient is infertile, and if the operative laparoscopy, that is diagnostic laparoscopy, is unsuccessful, then we go for assisted reproduction. That is, we go for test tube baby or intrauterine insemination. Thank you. That is all with my presentation today. Yeah, come. Please go over. So if you have any doubts, if you haven't understood anything, you can ask me questions. Thank you very much.
Can you explain?
Okay, laparoscopy, it is done through making the three holes in the abdomen. That is, one is through umbilical region, and the next two is in the side of the umbilical region. Right? Especially you can go inside and we'll see the endometriotic regions. And there we can do some procedures like, through laparoscopic, you don't have to open the abdomen, you go through the laparoscopic. So we can see there and we release there might be adhesions and adhesions or sakcha tya adhesions or release bhayo and endometric cyst if there is present we remove that endometric cyst preserving the like ramro ovary we can preserve and others we can remove that is very effective that is also very effective I mean laparoscopy is very expensive but we can also go for a laparotomically also we can do the same thing there is no difference only the difference is the scar and the hospital stay for the patient aru ke cha for laparoscopy you can see details when you come to the clinically and usually in our hospital in gynae especially in the gynae we don't go for laparoscopy we usually go for laparotomy because we surgeons we gynecologists are not so trained in laparoscopy so if the patient comes with endometriosis we go for laparotomy and sometimes we take the help of surgeons also for laparoscopy but usually we go for laparotomy aur kune cha aur kune if any questions ki time sake ko ki fir freeze bhayo 45 ta bhayo yesma kati 45 minutes ko bhanena time ta baki chha haina 40 minutes bhanu bhayo haina kati te matra question aaye
hajur hajur
kei chharu बुझौ त के व्हाट इज एंडोमेट्रियोसिस यूजुअली पेशेंट कम्स है ना यूजुअली इनफर्टाइल पेशेंट्स अनएबल टू कंसीव पेशेंट्स दे कम द ओपीडी है ना अनि व्हेन वी सेंड द इन्वेस्टिगेशंस मोस्ट ऑफ द पेशेंट्स हैव द रिपोर्ट्स लाइक एंडोमेट्रियोसिस इन अल्ट्रासोनोग्राफी है ना विल ट्रीट तो सेन अबाउट यू कम टू द ओपीडी when you will have the clinical postings abo aile explain garnu bhanda pani when you see the patients will retain more bujhau will get bujhna pani dherai bujhau haina kasto huncha kasto prakar cases haru auncha you will understand though it's a short topic it's very important and it comes in the short notes